What's up, you guys? Sean Rossap, Fightful.com, here with a name you know, and you might have seen me tweet recently when I saw a picture of Nydia. I said, man, I'd like to interview her. Well, as it turns out, the person who was in that picture with her, Gail Kim, hit you up and said, hey, do this interview. And it worked? How you doing?
No, I think it was actually meant to be because I was thinking about her. She must have called me with her mind.
Yeah.
And I was like, hey, girl, what's up? And she's like, dude, I was just talking about you. And she told me about you. She's like, I highly recommend him. So I vouch for him. Will you do an interview? I was like, yeah, sure. Any friend of Gail's.
That made me so happy. She posted a picture of you guys running into each other just randomly from maybe a year or two ago. So
it was like at an Eagles game.
Yeah. But where was this at? Was this in?
In Pennsylvania.
Okay. So Philadelphia Eagles. Okay.
Yeah, we were at the Eagles game, and we were in the shop, and David goes, is that Robert? And I looked, I go, it is. I go, where there's a Robert, there's a Gail. Yeah.
So, I mean, obviously you and Gail had worked together quite a bit. I mean, even after WWE, you all worked together quite a bit wrestling. So what was that like running into her again?
Oh, it's like riding a bike, you know? Like riding a bike, we just pretty much picked up wherever we left off, and we just have such good chemistry, and we kind of hit it off since the get-go. I don't know if she told you, but we did. It was her tryout match we did together, and we never wrestled each other before, and as soon as we locked up, it just kind of flowed. So needless to say, she got a job after that one.
Yeah, I mean, of course, many people know you from Tough Enough, the first season, which really, it was one of the earliest reality shows out there and a successful one at that. When you see all the reality shows today and you know that you were a part of that early success, how does that feel?
I guess.
Do you see yourself as a reality TV star when you look in the mirror?
No, not at all. My daughter, she's so funny about that stuff. She marks out and I'm just like, it's so normal to me, I guess, that it doesn't seem like a big deal. She's like, wow, I watched a video of you, or her friends will come up. It's like, I watched this or that, or you did an interview, et cetera, et cetera. Today, I didn't even tell her. And I was like, hey, Lil, I'm going to be in the room. I'm going to do an interview. If you need anything, you know, let me know. The boy I didn't even tell because he doesn't care. He's going to come in regardless. And she goes, you're doing an interview? I was just like, yeah. She's like, that is so cool. What time? And I told her, and she's like, oh, damn it, I have school, because she wanted to sit in and like do the interview with me. But yeah.
So, I mean, it seems like your daughter like thinks it's super awesome. I remember in a WWE.com article, you said that she would like threaten her classmates and be like, my mom was a wrestler and she'll beat you up.
She would. It spread like fire. It's like, Miss Nydia, were you a wrestler? Lil said you were going to beat me up. I was like, no, you can't tell people that.
So I know that obviously reality TV has been more, I don't want to say refined, but are homogenized, produced in the last 20 years.
You can say refined. It is beautiful now. I watch like the Total Divas. God, I would have been so much fun to be in that show.
And that stuff is largely scripted. I mean, that stuff is just largely created for you.
Don't ruin it for me.
I mean, come on. Come on. They've got cameras there when people are breaking up backstage. But you,
that's fantastic.
Like, do you watch Total Divas, Total Bellas, that stuff?
I mean, I don't watch that. I'm the most boring person you'll ever meet. I really don't watch that much TV. But, you know, if I do, that's a really fun one to watch.
Yeah, I mean, I can tell you that, like, when I would teach women's kickboxing and people would find out what I did for a living, which would be covering pro wrestling, they wouldn't say, do you know The Undertaker or John Cena? They'd say, do you know Naomi and Jimmy Uso? Because they would be on Total Divas or something like that. And that's how they would know these people. So, I mean, it does connect with a different audience too.
It really does. It's like a broader, I mean, you know, it's just a broader audience. I feel like I got recognized a ton with Tough Enough. I mean, still some with WWE, but with Tough Enough, it was just like, it's pretty wild.
That's what I was going to ask. Did you find yourself like getting recognized by non-wrestling fans because of that all the time?
Yes. I remember one time we went to a club. It was all five of us. And we went to a club in Connecticut and they were just like, oh my God. They knew everything. They knew everyone. So that was really weird. Definitely different than with wrestling.
And I think a lot of people that watch today might not realize this wasn't just like something that was on and promoted by WWE. This was on MTV.
MTV.
Yeah. And like the prime.
Carson Daly over here.
Prime TRL, Road Rules, Real World right. era, you were on MTV.
Yes. Definitely broader audience for sure. The early ages, I feel I got recognized more like during the, like I said, during the Tough Enough years than I did with the wrestling. So.
And now it's nonstop episodes of ridiculousness on MTV. That's the only thing that's on the channel anymore.
But, is it really?
Oh yeah, that's it, 24/7. But did you feel
the music part is gone?
Oh yeah, big time, long gone. Did you feel they represented you fairly on there? I mean, I know that you said that they definitely tried to make a show of it, but
they made a show. It was so funny. I remember watching the first few episodes when it seemed like there was something going on with it between myself and Chris Nifong. And it was so edited. Like, he looks like he's in a boy band. That was like a completely different episode. I love NSYNC. And the way they pieced it together, I was like, God damn it. It makes it seem like I have a crush on him. It was like two completely different episodes. Because they'll ask you questions, you know? It's like, what kind of music do you like? Or what
sure.
kind of band? So you have to, oh, I like NSYNC. I like pop, you know? So they pieced it together. They knew what they were doing.
Did they ever script anything?
There's a lot of stuff they left out, too. But we don't talk about that.
Really? What'd they leave out?
Nope.
What did they leave
There's
out of there?
There's a lot of other stories there.
My gosh. And I mean, that was, you look back and there were a whole lot of people. It's funny because there are several people from the subsequent seasons of Tough Enough that didn't even make it on the show and ended up becoming big wrestling stars. You, I had always heard, took to wrestling really, really well on that show. And you spoke with a lot of confidence. You're like, I had a feeling I was going to win this show because I took to it so well. I mean,
they did. They said I would. They would tell me that. They're like, oh, you're like a duck in water. It's like, oh, cool. But in the show, it wasn't portrayed that way. So it was really like whenever towards the later seasons, I remember Josh Maven and I would go eat. And I was just like, man, Maven, it's like, you're looking pretty good. It's like, I'm not looking so good. They're like, well, you know, just give it a second. Maybe it's like an underdog type of angle that yeah. they're going with, you know, because we were watching it and we didn't know who was going to win at the end. So you're watching the entire show, you're seeing how they're portraying you, and you're like, oh, it's not looking very good, guys.
So do you think that they did that for dramatic effect to make it seem like it was a shock win when you were like, I'm winning this thing?
Well, I thought, I mean, not to sound arrogant, but I, you yeah. know, I thought I was better. And then when you see yourself being portrayed as just really struggling, I was like, that's not really accurate, but damn it. I don't think, it's not looking so good, but it worked out.
A lot of people always wonder, do you ever keep in touch with anybody from Tough Enough? I mean, right now, as we're filming this, Chris Nowinski is at an AEW event doing concussion protocol with them. You've got Josh Matthews still on TV. Maven has appeared on the bump. So you've got a few people that are still loosely connected and stuff, but it's
right.
But you don't keep
no,
in touch with
anybody? No, I mean, the person that I kept in touch with the longest was Josh. But now, yeah, it's just so, it's tricky with kids, you know?
Sure.
It's like time flies by and you don't even realize that it's been that long, you know?
How produced was that show as far as like, did they give you lines to say? I mean, I know there are always like voiceover things and things you might have to redub, especially if you're not mic'd up or anything like that. But did they ever just feed you stuff?
Not necessarily, no. I think, like you say, it's more fine-tuned and narrowed now. Back then, they would ask you questions that you would have to answer a certain way. Mm-hmm. And that's how they got it. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, they would set up the questions to make
Pretty
sure
much.
They got the answer that they wanted.
Yeah, so it's like it's stuff you couldn't avoid.
So you win that. How did you feel when you win that? And how far ahead did you know, or was it a legitimate surprise?
Oh, it's a super surprise. We didn't know.
Oh,
so they
amazing.
Took us on the very last, it was supposed to be the last filming episode before the show aired. And they took us to, it was actually the Trump Tower, and everybody was dressed up and we were going to have the awards ceremony. And when we got there, they didn't open the doors. And they were like, okay, guys, you're going to go back home. You're going to come back here in a few weeks and you're going to start training again. And we're going to do the last episode live. So we thought we were going to find out. Nobody slept the night before. Like, we're all super nervous. And it's like, nobody's talking on the way there. And they're like, psych, you're going to have to wait, you know, 3-4 more months. So they sent us back home for a few weeks, and then we started training again. And that's whenever we were watching the show as it went week by week. And the last show was live. They're like, everybody prepare a speech. And yep, that was amazing. That was it.
And we were talking off the air, you ended up moving to Louisville to go to OVW. And
OVW.
It's funny, there are a lot of people that, whether or not they were in the business before or not, they still live in Louisville or that surrounding area because they moved there for that. What was OVW like?
That was probably the funnest time during my wrestling career. Like, it was so nice. And I got so lucky because there were so many cool people there. Like, Cena trained with us, Shelton, Orton, Bautista, O'Hare.
Yeah.
So we just had, Jindrak was there. Mm-hmm. Rob Conway, like we just had such a Eugene, yeah, Nick Dinsmore. Yeah, we had such a fun group. Victoria, God, yeah.
I interviewed her recently. Group. She was wonderful.
Oh, she is. She is fantastic. Yeah, so we just had such a great group and we became so close. Like when I got there, I remember, so Jim Cornette ran him Danny Davis. They both ran OVW, and Cornette was really strict about who could hang out together, you know? So we weren't, like, if you're a baby face, it's like you're not hanging out with any of the heels. And I was a baby face, and most of my friends were heels. So it's like Victoria, O'Hare, Cena, they were all, like, in that group. And Shelton and I were on the outskirts looking in. It's like, part of that world, you know? So we couldn't hang out. And we snuck out one day, Victoria and I, we went to a Hooters to watch a pay-per-view. So we're eating, and next day we go to practice, and Cornette calls us in. And he's like, hey, so we hear that you guys were hanging out at blah, 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 blah. It's like, oh, shoot. So we got fined for doing that. And another day, it was Dinsmore's birthday, so everybody decided to go out. There was like about 20 of us. And you're counting heads, like baby face heel, baby face heel, baby face heel. It's like, this is like $10,000 worth of fines, guys. Like, we can't get busted today.
Did you all get in any trouble for that? What, that one?
No, not that one night. Yeah, it was fantastic.
Apparently,
wrestling fans did not hang out at that club.
And I mean, a lot of people forget, like, not because today, Orton, Cena, Batista, Shelton, like that class is fondly remembered like for that. But I mean, the women's class there too, as you mentioned, like you and Victoria were a part of that right then. And
right.
When you see I don't know if you have seen where women's wrestling is now, how does that progression and how things change, how does that look to you? If it were more like that back then, do you think you would have stuck around longer?
It seems, and from what I've heard, it seems like a lot of the politics in the locker room has changed quite a bit since I was there. And the politics were probably the biggest issue for me, you know, because we always got our wrestling in. I was on SmackDown, and they were really trying to develop that, like with Fit Finley. That was his project. That was his baby. So we got our fix through there. Yeah. For me, it was just there's too many politics for me. And it was one of those where it's just like a lot of sports, if you work hard, you'll see it, right? Like you'll see the payoff. And with this one, it seemed like it didn't really matter if you worked hard. So there was really nothing that you can do to, I guess, get ahead if somebody didn't want you to. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So there was really nothing to work towards. It's like, oh, you plateaued it. If you can work hard all your life, and it's really not going to get you that far, you know? At least that's what it felt like to me.
I remember a story that you told about Batista, like having some harsh words that you said were more like a helpful thing. Like he was trying to, like, help you along, but in wrestling, it's often via tough love. Can you tell us about that?
Yes, I was running home. So I moved to Louisville. I didn't think I was going to be there very long, right? I was just like, I'll be there for a few weeks and then, you know, on the road. So naive, right? So I stayed at like an extended stay and I didn't have a car, and I would jog to the gym, get my workout on, and jog back to my extended stay. And on the way back, I'm jogging and a car pulls up next to me. And I look and it's Bautista and he rolls his window down. He goes, get in the car. So I got in the car and he's like, hey, man, you're rubbing everybody the wrong way. And it's like, it's stuff that I didn't understand because I did get in the business so quickly. And I don't know the rules, you know, or these unwritten rules. And he's like, you're coming off like not respectful. And then you're winking at people. I was like, man, I wink at people because I'm so nervous. It's like, you guys are ginormous. It's like a whole new world. I left my home. I don't know what I'm doing. So it's, you know,
yeah.
It's like, it's actually like a nervous thing. And he kind of like told me how to behave in a locker room, you know, and that really helped. And when I got on the road, the Dudley Boys gave me a hard time and he was with them in that group.
Yeah.
And he really stuck his neck out for me. So I will forever be grateful. And then the Dudley Boys were fantastic, but you know, at first they were a little rough until he came to the rescue.
Do you remember any other like tough love situations, whether it be from a member of the female roster, male roster, agent, producer, anything like that?
Or I mean, the girls were fantastic. Dawn Marie can be a tough cookie, but she took an instant liking to me. So that worked out. And then it was Tori, and Tori is just really, really sweet. So I didn't have that from the girls. When I got into OVW, we used to have a kickout drill, right? So you would kick out. And during the kickout drill, these guys would not budge. So they would lay on top of you and you're trying to kick out and they're like 300 pounds and it wouldn't work. And one of them comes and here's like the next 20 and you're like blown completely. Yes. Right. So I learned that if you stick your finger in somebody's butt, they jump.
The oil. So that'll work. That'll work. That makes them.
So it's like I would lay down and it's like, find it. Oh, look at how fast you jump. And they, you know, they actually loved it. They started treating me a little bit differently in a positive way after that. So.
Oh, man. So how long did you end up living in Louisville?
A few years. Two, 3 years. Mm-hmm. Because then I met Eric Angle there and we got engaged. And he was still training whenever I was on the road. So I stuck around for a little bit longer. And it was fun. Like, it was so beautiful. It was, like I said, Louisville. That was some of the funnest time in wrestling. We were just such a close group and everybody was so passionate about wrestling. You know, they were there for the right reasons. And it was fantastic.
So you had mentioned off the air about your sister getting into OVW. Now, I also remember you told me that originally your sister is the one that got you to try out for Tough Enough. Like, you were going to go to wrestling school, but then apparently there was a commercial and she got it recorded and you were like, okay, let's do this.
Yes. So I was, I just got back from Mexico. Like I said, I was like super hippie, no drinking, no smoking, no meat. I lived in an apartment, like kind of far away from everybody, no TV, like, you know, just like total nomad. And my sister had a TV. Like most people do. And she's like, hey, dude, I saw this commercial. And it's like, it's for a wrestling show. And whoever wins gets a 1-year contract. You need to send in the video. It's like, oh, cool. So I send in the video and everything like within, it's so crazy. Like, I guess when things are meant to be, sometimes it just happens so easily. It's like you send in a video and then a few months later, you're there, right?
Yeah. And you had said that she did obviously some training there and like she followed your path effectively, right?
She did. So she definitely had her foot in the door and she left college to go with me and do wrestling. And she was actually pretty good. She was in Bowling Services, BS, in OVW. Yeah. And she was doing really well. But then she just lost focus and she started partying too much and not going to practice. So that kind of fell apart. But
has that ever been anything that you had heard her bring up again after that? Like, oh, you know what? Maybe I'd give it another go. Or was she pretty much well out of it?
She was done.
And that's a lot of times that's hard to do for wrestlers. Like that's why I think your case is so fascinating. Like you were like, well, I'm done.
Yeah.
And
it's, I just really, you know, I like my happiness and if it wasn't making me happy, then it's just like, okay, cut, find something else. So.
I'll tell you something
but
that made me.
It was a beautiful moment.
Yeah.
It was a beautiful memory, and I made friends, and it's just like great memories. So it's not like I regret it or anything. It was fantastic.
Well, the angle with you and Jamie Noble definitely made me happy. That was one of my favorite things. Like, and I mean, okay, I'm from Kentucky. I see people that act like that all the time. Like, I look out my back door. I see people that act like that all the time.
Paul How Heyman, funny is that?
Paul Heyman once told me that his original idea was like you all to portray the natural born killers couple.
Yes.
And
yeah,
this was a big deal for you. When did you find out that this was going to be the direction? Because I'm sure you were still in OVW when you heard that.
I was still in OVW, and you remember how they were setting it up? Like they would have the female come out and like do something to Hurricane, cause a match, et cetera, yes. et cetera. And I'm watching, I'm in OVW, you know, and we'll go to Hooters or we'll go to somebody's house and watch. And I had no idea that that was going to be my role. I'm just watching. It's like, ooh, I wonder who it's going to be, you know? I thought it was going to be Tori. Not Tori Wilson, but you remember Tori from
DX and
right,
yeah.
And then they called me and they're like, "Okay, cool, you're debuting." Still, I didn't know. I didn't know what I was gonna do, or if I was gonna do another Tough Enough thing, or who knows. And I go in and they give me this promo, and it's just like pages and pages, and I'm just like, "Oh shit!" It's like a skit. I was like, "Oh my god, it's me! That's me! That's so exciting!" So, yeah, we did the promo, and I had to eat some beef jerky. I was like, that was my first taste of meat in years because I was vegetarian at the time. So that was probably the most challenging thing there. And they thought it's going to take us forever to finish that take because I never really done one before. And, you know, they were just bringing so many people and so many angles together. And it took us one take. We did it on one take. Wow. And everybody's just like, what do we do for the rest of the day? It's like, I don't know. But Paul Heyman coached me so much. He set up such a clear vision of what he had that it was just so easy to fall in character. And I loved it. It was such a great character.
He seems like he's...
tennis shoes.
He seems like he's really good at envisioning things that'll work for people because... Talking to you now, the first thing that I think of would not be, okay, she's going to play a trailer trash gimmick. Like that's,
right?
That's not the type of thing.
But it worked perfect because, A, I hate girly stuff, you know? Like, I'm not one to, let's go get my hair. Like, I don't like that stuff. I hate heels. I can't walk in heels. So you put me in tennis shoes and shorts to walk out in the ring. I was just like, thank you.
So that first day, you're going around, you're introducing yourself to people. A lot of these people already know who you are because of you being on
TV.
Was there any pushback?
Which is still hard to believe, you know? It's like, it's still hard to believe. I ran into Hulk Hogan and he knew who I was and it blew my fucking mind. I was just like, you know me? I was like, oh my God, you're fucking Hulk Hogan. How is this even happening?
Do you remember any particularly positive or negative interactions that you had, like meeting people, like anybody that made an impression on you? Besides Hulk Hogan, obviously.
Hulk Hogan, obviously. I mean, I always liked Mankind.
Great guy.
But I didn't know the effect that it was going to have to actually meet him. You know, like I was a huge rock fan and Mankind was cool. But when I met him, I lost my stuff. Like it was like, it just like this emotion came out of me. So it was during Tough Enough and pretty regularly, we'll have somebody come in. Triple H came in, Kurt Angle came in, and Al would tell us, if you mark out, you're going to have to do 100 squat thrusts, right? And for us, that was like the worst punishment in the entire world because it's like at about 40, 50, your eyes start crossing and you start seeing the little bubbles and the lights. You know, people would throw up. I think everybody threw up except for Maven and I doing these stupid squat thrusts. So we were very careful not to embarrass Al by acting like a huge fan whenever one of the superstars would come in. And I remember when he walked in, I was in the ring, Maven and Josh were wrestling and I was the referee. And he walked in the door and I looked at him and I slid out the ring and I looked at Al, I said, I'll take my squat thrust. And I went up to him, I go, yes. I was like, I'll take my squat thrust. It was just like I couldn't help it. It was stronger than I was. And I was just like, hi, I love you. And he's like, you know, you're here because of me, right? And I was like, really? He's like, yep. He's like, I saw something about you and I pushed for you.
Oh, like, man. He is so, like, naturally funny. I interviewed him about a year ago, and we go to his room, which is around the corner from where we're doing the interview. And he's got this green drink. And he's like, "Have you ever had one of these green drinks before?" And I was like, "No, I've not." And he was like, "You're very aware that you are drinking something healthy when you drink this."
Yes.
He was amazing. Like, he was so good. Do you remember the first time you met Vince McMahon, whether it be as a part of Tough Enough or then when you got called up?
Oh, God. It's always so intimidating to see him that I can't really say I remember the first time. Yeah. I think it was all a huge... I think every time it's just a blur.
Yeah.
It's like... And you just kind of like stumble through it, and it's just like catch your breath afterwards.
So you all
His
are doing...
presence is just...
Yeah.
Have you met him?
No, I've not. I've not.
Oh,
I've
my
only
God.
Done...
He's so intimidating, and it's just like the way he carries himself. It's just so regal. You're just like... It's very, very intimidating. Like I said, it's just like a blur, and then you snap out of it. It's like, what just happened? So, it's like, did I say something stupid? Probably.
How were your interactions with him? Did you interact with him much, or was it mainly Paul Heyman because he was kind of steering that ship on SmackDown?
Mainly Paul Heyman. But like I said, I don't really recall his interactions very sure. much because it was a blur. One time, Jamie and I made suggestions on where a character should go to him, even though we talked to him like very rarely, and that's what came out of our mouths.
Oh.
It probably wasn't the wisest thing. The man knows his stuff.
To which one, Vince or Paul?
Vince.
And how did he react to that?
He just said, "Oh, okay," and then he walked away, and immediately we were just like, "Why'd you let me do that? Why'd you let me do that?"
I mean, you all got a lot of positive reception for how you all portrayed that gimmick. It was one of the more fun things on that show.
It was so fun. We were going from heels to baby faces. Like, I remember towards the end when they decided to split us up, which I wish they would have kept us together for a lot longer because it was starting to turn. We would go as heels and the crowds would start cheering for us.
Yeah.
So when we were beating up, you know, Hurricane or whoever, people were like, "Yeah, beat them!" It's like, no, they're you guys got it wrong. They're the good guys. We're the bad guys. You're supposed to boo us, you know? But it's like, yeah, it started shifting. I remember one of our, towards the end, we went to England and it was just like huge pops. It's like, yeah, I like this. And it's kind of like The Rock. Like The Rock went from being a baby face to heel to a baby face. People just kind of like started liking it.
They enjoyed watching you guys. You guys were entertaining, and especially in that era, if you're entertaining, then people are like, "All right, this is somebody I want to see."
Yeah, it was very fun. It was very, and for a woman, because you know all the girls were like kind of supermodels and like, "Look at me, I'm beautiful." And this character was just so different from that. It was just so refreshing to play. You know, it did feel like a game because it was just like, "Yeah, let's go have fun," and there was just a lot of freedom too. Like you didn't have to be anyone. You could just, she was kind of unhinged,
of course,
so you could do whatever.
You all did the split. You all had, I think it was your first pay-per-view match at No Way Out in I want to say 04, but I remember you also saying you did not like doing the blind thing because you had to portray it all the time.
I had to close. Yes, so we would go like, we went overseas and they were like, "Hey Nydia, remember that you're blind, so I don't want to see you out in the lobby."
Yeah.
You know, walking around, and then you have to go pretend that you're blind at the show because that just kills it, right?
So did you have to order food in or something?
So that's the thing, right? So one day we got in, we were in Australia, and I call Don, nothing. Tori, nothing. Jamie, nothing. They're all gone, right? So I'm just like, damn it, I'm fucking hungry. So I get in the elevator hoping that I'm not going to run into anyone, and I run into Bob Holly. And I was like, "Dude, I'm hungry. I need to go downstairs and I need to get some food. Can you guide me through the crowd?"
Oh, he for sure ribbed you for that. He for sure did. There's no way.
I bumped into every single wall and plant and anything. He was just like, "Boom. Oh, watch out for that. Boom. Watch out for that." I was just like, "Son of a bitch. Just get me to my, just get me to my meal." It was the longest walk.
Oh, that's amazing.
Yes.
So how long did you have to pretend to be blind again?
Way too long.
Way too long.
And I think that was what it was. They were supposed to. Yes, that's when we talked to Vince. Well, you talked to Vince because they were going to, remember how we won that money, right?
Yes.
Or we inherited that money. Yes. We inherited that money. And then Tori got into Playboy and they were like, well, what you're going to do is you're going to go to the best Swedish doctor and you're going to go, because I was going to get a breast augmentation and I needed some time off. So that's a lot of information, huh?
I mean...
Yeah, so I was gonna get a breast augmentation. I was like, I asked for the time off, they approved it, so they wrote it into the storyline. And what they wanted to do is, like, they were gonna send me to the best doctor in Sweden, and I was gonna come back and we were gonna, like, highlight them, etc., etc., and that was the way the story was gonna go. And Jamie and I was just like, yeah, it's kind of anticlimactic, like, how far is that gonna go? Yeah. Which in hindsight, it probably would have gone far, right? But we pitched a different direction and he said yes, and then they made me blind and I was just like, we shouldn't have messed with him, like now he's messing with me, he made me blind.
Man, so yeah. When that was coming to an end, how did you feel about that, and who tells you, hey, you know, you and Jamie are gonna split, you're headed to Raw, all that?
Yeah, I mean, so they tried to move me to Raw.
I know before. One happened before the other. Yeah.
Yeah, no, they've been trying to move me to Raw for a bit. Like, it wasn't the first conversation they had about moving to Raw. They were like, you wrestle really well, and that's where the belt is. You need to move to Raw. And we talked them out of it. Like I said, it was a really tight group. And I didn't want to leave, and they didn't want me to leave. So we would kind of, like, corner Johnny Ace or Fit or Dean and kind of plead our case. It's like, man, it's like, do you really need it? Anybody, you got this person. I was like, I don't even want the belt. Just leave me over here. And it worked. Like, it bought me some time in SmackDown. And that last one, there was nothing we could say. They heard it all. They were just like, dude, you're going to Raw. It's like.
So you did get drafted to Raw. And after that,
Called it the A show.
Yeah, it didn't seem like it was for you. It didn't seem like there was as much fulfilling stuff. I think the only pay-per-view match you had there was a schoolgirls battle royal.
No, I wasn't a fan of Raw. I think that's when I wasn't a fan of Raw. I mean, I already knew it, and I might have gone in with a bad attitude because I didn't want to leave SmackDown. Sure. It's like they pretty much, like, had to drag me while I'm holding on to the door, and I didn't want to be there, and I probably didn't have the best attitude about it, but it was just so different. There were a lot more egos, I feel like, in Raw than there were on SmackDown. I remember the first time I realized it, somebody asked me, I was in Raw, and they were like, what are you going to do tonight? And I was like, oh, I don't have any plans. What are you going to do tonight? They were like, on the show. I was like, oh, on SmackDown, what are you going to do tonight? Means something completely different, you know?
Yeah.
It was a very social group. And in Raw, it was just mostly, it was work. They were there.
I do remember that summer they did a top contendership on a pole match where you had to go up and get, like, a contract, and then Trish came out and beat you, like, immediately after, if I remember right.
Yeah.
How does that even come together?
I think by then I had already tapped out. It was so hard to put matches together on Raw because on SmackDown it was very – it was just a team effort, you know? It's like Tori or with Dawn or even, like, with the guys, whenever you put your piece together, it was for the good of the match, you know? Sure. So it's like, you're going to do that, you're going to do this, you're going to do that, you're going to do this. And for Raw, in order to even make it fair, it was such a huge fight that by then I had already just given up. It was just like, do whatever you want. Like, I'm not going to do this for 6 hours so that I can get in, you know? And the clothesline. It's like,
I do remember you saying that by the time the release happened, you were just like, well, I was thinking about quitting anyway.
I wanted to. I was actually afraid of breaching my contract. So when Johnny Ace called and he told me that, he's like, are you okay? I was like, yeah, I'm fine. I go, how are you? He's like, oh, it's been an awful day. I still have a few more phone calls to make, blah, 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 blah. So I was actually consoling him, you know?
Yeah.
It's like, oh, Johnny, you'll be okay. Just keep at it, bud. You know? But I was ready to go. So like I said, I wasn't being a good employee. Like, I wasn't really trying. And they made the right choice.
And you seemed ready to go. I actually, if I remember this, it had been 13, 14 years ago that I remember you talking about it, that like you and Linda Miles actually discussed quitting before that. And then she was like, yeah, I think I am. And then she did quit.
Right.
So, right. I mean, you were ready to go.
Yeah. I know it sounds awful for a wrestling show, but you know, it's not for everybody.
It isn't for everybody. I mean, there's, quite frankly, there's a woman that worked in Impact Wrestling and she just kind of finished up because it just wasn't what she was happy with. It wasn't keeping her in the right space mentally. So, and
that's a really hard, it's really hard to maintain a good, I don't know how it is now, but back then there was just so many politics and it was like, I even came back home and then I hung out with friends that I'd known all my life and I said something and I go, but I didn't mean it that way. Yeah. What I meant was, and they were like, dude, you're really paranoid about the things that you say. Like you're not speaking freely. I was like, man, because over there you have to like watch what you say. And this is more of a Raw thing. Like on SmackDown, everybody was really cool. But on Raw, you have to watch what you say because everything was taken so out of context, you know? So it was a really... For me, it was just a very hard way to live, you know?
After you left WWE.
Am I being a bummer?
No, not at all. Oh my gosh. Compared to some of the things that people say, no, not at all. Not at all. And I mean, right after WWE, it seemed like you traveled when you wrestled a lot. You were overseas, you were in Puerto Rico,
yes.
Mexico. You did a lot of traveling.
So I didn't do any shows in the US, I only did shows to places that I wanted to go to. And then I would extend my stay, right? So it's just like, oh, cool, free ticket to Italy. Awesome. 3 weeks, make it for six, you know? And then it's like, that's fine. You guys go home. I'll stay here for a little bit. But it was great because I got to do so much traveling. And it's like, when I was in the WWE, we did a lot of traveling, but everything was so condensed that we didn't really have a lot of time to see the places. So this was just a perfect opportunity to... you flew there for free, you did a few shows, and then it's like a paid vacation, right?
And then from what I remember and what I can find, you were working people like Gail Kim and Linda Miles, who you were very familiar with.
Yes.
Was that I don't want to say a contingent factor on you going over there, but it had to feel good to be working people like that.
Yeah. I was very lucky that I knew I wasn't going to do it for very long, and I had enough money saved to where I could have a little fun with it, right? So it's like I would pick jobs to where I was working with people that I was familiar with because there's a lot of people that are not trained well.
Yeah.
Out there and they will put you at risk, you know? So it was just like, man, it's got to be somebody that was like trained by the Wii if we're going to do this, right?
Did I read right that you went and wrestled in South Korea at one point?
Mm-hmm. With
how,
you.
How was that?
It was awesome. I was actually in Puerto Rico and it was Gail that called me and she's like, hey buddy, it's like, I need you to come wrestle with me. She was wrestling someone, but she wanted to like add me to the mix. And she's like, can you come? I was like, all right. So I went straight from Puerto Rico there and it was cold. And it's like, all I had was like shorts and mini skirts, but it was a lot of fun.
And another match that stands out to me that I'm able to see after you wrestled in WWE, AJ Styles and Gail Kim against Christopher Daniels and Nydia. And Daniels and AJ are still at it. AJ is one of the top stars in wrestling.
They're both phenomenal. They're like such great wrestlers and they're like fantastic human beings.
Yeah.
Like I love them both. I was just like, I just want to. Yeah, they're great. That was a lot of fun.
At that time, because I know there was a lot of TNA talent on that tour, did they ever reach out to you and be like, hey, maybe do some shows in the States? Did you get any companies reaching out to you like that?
I think it was very clear where I was heading. Mm-hmm. Because, they would, like Gail would pretty much set all this stuff up. It was very clear that I wasn't going to do it. I mostly did it for her, you know? And I think it was pretty obvious.
And I mean, nostalgia is a big thing in wrestling. And if you decided, hey, tomorrow I want to be a wrestler again, my gosh, I mean, you would be able to get bookings somewhere. That's the nature of wrestling
right
now, even in a pandemic. Have you had anybody reach out? I mean, obviously, you're not an easy person to contact on social media or anything like that.
I don't have any social media.
I noticed that.
I'm completely off the grid. So it's like, if you see anything out there, it's totally, it's yes. not me. I've had some people, it's like, man, I messaged you on whatever. I'm just like, I don't have anything. It's like, you see any personal pictures of me? It's like, that's because it's not me.
And you don't do signings, I don't believe, or meet and greets, anything like that. You are a private person.
It's such a tricky business because it will keep you there. Like, you yes. know, it's just like that little carrot. So it's just like, it's kind of like smoking, you know. It's like, if you're addicted to smoking, you can't have one cigarette. So I just kind of like cut it off completely. And then every now and then I'll be like, hey, you know what? I kind of miss it. Or I'm going to go see a friend over in here. I'm going to be in the area. Like one time I did a signing. You could go shower. I did a signing because I wanted to go to a concert. So this Italian singer was going to be playing in New Jersey. And somebody called me. It's like, hey, you want to do a show? I was like, I actually need to get there that weekend. Yes, I will do a show.
That's fantastic. Mm-hmm. And like, as we wrap up, like, have there been any promoters that have managed to get your stuff and be like, hey, one more match? I know it's been a while, but.
No.
Interesting. Well,
no way, man. That stuff hurts. I don't know. You know this. Wrestling hurts.
It does. It does.
It, like, beats you up. Like, your body is, like, your bones. It's like, I can't take that stuff anymore.
So, considering that you're not on social media a lot, I don't know if you realize the buzz that came out. Like, I think it was 4.5 years ago. You popped up at the Hall of Fame.
Oh, yes. Nora called me.
Yeah, people were like, wait, is that who we think it is? And then it was. And there you are, not looking a day older than you were when you left. And people were like, what's going on here? How did this come about? You said Molly Holly called you up?
Yeah. Yeah, Nora called me. She's like, hey, I'm going to be in town. You want to go to you want to be my date for WrestleMania? I was just like, oh, God, yes. It's like, I haven't seen you in so long. Let's hang out. So that's how that happened.
So did you catch up with anybody there? Did you go to WrestleMania?
Everybody. Yes, I caught up with everybody except for Cena. I haven't seen him.
Aww.
Last time I saw him, he had a concert in Italy, and I happened to be there. And that's the last time I saw him. I went to his concert, and then we hung out afterwards. But, yeah, that's the only person that I didn't get to get. I caught up with Randy. I saw. Yeah, it was fantastic.
So
Candace.
So you went to actual WrestleMania as well, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I went there and I hung out. Yeah, it was with Candace. So Shelton is a good friend of Candace, and he was around, or he's still around. And he would tell me, he's like, you need to meet this girl. He's like, you two are going to get along so well. It's like, I talked to her and it just reminds me of you. And he was right. As soon as I met her, we just kind of like hit it off. So we spent, like, I went with Nora and I hung out with her too, but I spent my weekend with Candace.
And there had to be a lot of surprised faces there because you have been completely off the wrestling scene for a decade at that point.
Right.
So, right. Man, that's
the. Except for Jamie Noble, that son of a gun. Yeah. So he walks by me and he's like, hey, girl. And I'm just like, I turned around because he was with his wife. And I guess, I don't know, maybe he's not allowed to talk to girls. Who knows? But I go, hey, Jamie, it's me, Nydia. You remember me? We used to be partners. And he goes, I know who you are. I was like, what kind of greeting is that? So he turned around and he made up for it. But
did you hear that, like, a few months after that, he got stabbed? Did you not know that? He honest to God, got stabbed.
It wasn't me.
Yeah. It's that Heyman storyline coming full circle.
Sucker.
He apparently got into a dispute with a driver. Like, it was September of 2016, and the guy stabbed him twice.
Holy cow.
Yeah.
He's fine though, right?
Yeah, he's fine. He's fine. He's still doing the job, doing great, obviously.
God, he's so good. Isn't he excellent?
I mean, in the ring and everything that I hear, because I'll ask people, like, who produced this? If something amazing happens, I'm like, hey, who put this together? Who helped you?
Right.
And that is a common name, is Jamie Noble helped put this together. Oh,
he is just like Eddie Guerrero, like, in that category, you know?
Yeah. So as we finish up, tell the people what you're up to nowadays. I mean, you're obviously a very proud parent. You seem very happy and fulfilled with your life right now.
Yeah, I'm a mom. I stay at home, and then I do dab in real estate. So
nice.
That's actually like a hobby turned into a business type of deal. So I love that. We built a house, and I just fell in love with the process. I was just like, this is so interesting. Like, it's construction stuff. And I was so enamored by it. I would walk around and look at newly built homes and ask questions. And I even got like offered jobs doing that because I liked it so much. And then afterwards I kept looking and looking, and so we rehabbed some houses, and then that's our retirement plan. We'll rehab houses and then we will rent them. So yeah, that's my passion right now in the children.
It's always so awesome to see like happy endings from stuff like that. And I mean, you seemed happy when you left WWE, and it doesn't seem like that has subsided at all. It seems like you're doing really good. And that's always something that we like to see. And it's something we see a lot more out of this generation of wrestlers than like from the 80s, 90s, and 70s.
Yeah, it feels like a lot of those guys would kind of just like when you perform, it's like this adrenaline rush. And I think some people really can't separate themselves from that. And they will continue to be in this really bad relationship just for that high, you know?
I mean, we talked about Kevin Thorne, I think, off the air. And when I went and interviewed him, I had people saying, oh, you mean Mordecai? What happened to him? Is he okay? And I'm like, yeah, he lives
in a... We talked good about Mordecai.
Yeah, I was like, well... You know. I was like, well, he's super happy, has a huge house, and is doing great in Indianapolis. So
right.
He found something that made him happy. Oh, and he's still doing all kinds of wrestling shows in the area, too, whenever he wants.
Right.
But it makes me so happy that you were willing to do this, and you're so generous with your time. I want to thank you so much for doing
this.
Thank you,
Sean. I had a really good time.
Yeah, of course. Guys, leave a thumbs up on the video, subscribe. You don't have any socials, so I mean, people can send out a bat signal for you, maybe, right?
You have no idea how many events I missed because they were like, I was like, what? You had a party? It's like, yeah, I posted it on Facebook. Damn it, I forget that you don't have Facebook. It's like, call me.
Guys, until next time, we're out.